Good morning, church, and welcome to worship. It's good to have us together in the way that we can. An announcement before we move on with the sermon. On the page that you're at, probably you're on the website, mvcglenwood.org, you see we have a page for COVID-19 resources. I recommend those. There's a lot of good things on there, including fighter verses, verses to memorize in an uncertain time, really hold us. Also, our help team announcement. And this week, we'll be starting a new Zoom Bible study to really unpack the sermon and take it into application. So take a look at those. Let me pray for us, and then we'll get started with the sermon. Dear Heavenly Father, God, I thank you for this day that we have. God, I thank you for technology that you inspired so that we could still get together and as God's people meet and proclaim the gospel, receive it, and be reminded of who we are because of it. We ask, Holy Spirit, that you would move in your power, create in us a heart to know you and to fall in love with you. Show us yourself. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're in a series called Finding Jesus, a journey through the book of Luke, in which we're looking to find Jesus either for the first time or in a fresh way. And so take your Bibles, if you have them, smartphones, and go to Luke chapter 4. That's where we'll be studying. My parents live in Mesa, Arizona. This last week, my mom was telling me about something that took place in Sam's Club. They've been having a run on toilet paper there. And there was a lady, a middle-aged lady, who was pushing not a cart, but bigger, a hand truck loaded with toilet paper. And while she was moving toward the checkout, a little old lady came up to her. That's what my mom called her, and she knows. She's little-ish and old-ish. So she said, a little old lady came up to this woman and said, "Man, I can't find any toilet paper. And every time I come here, they're out. Would you be willing to sell me and let me buy just one of your packages?" And the younger woman thought about it for a sec. She looked up at her mountain of toilet paper and down at this little old lady and then said, "Nah, I don't think so," and kept trucking to the checkout line. Now, sadly, that's not probably very remarkable in the time that we're living in, and it deserves some analysis, so let's think about that. The root cause of this lady's lack of generosity was really a belief that there's my house and my needs, and there's your house and your needs, and never the two shall meet. And so, really taking in that me versus you, I have no responsibility for your needs, is living with a thick moat between me and you. And so it's fortunate that this morning Christ's teaching really pushes back on the my house versus your house mentality. So let's pick it up. Let's start off where we left off last week. Jesus has been in the desert being tempted by Satan, and this is what happens directly afterwards. He comes back in power. Luke chapter 4, verse 14. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and a report about him went out throughout all the countryside. And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. And he came to Nazareth, where he'd been brought up. And as was his custom, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read. And the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. And he unrolled the scroll, and he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Jesus here quotes Isaiah 61, one of the most well-known messianic prophecies written about what the Messiah of God would do when he came to set up his kingdom. The Jews of Jesus' day were familiar with this prophecy and understood it in almost exclusive material terms of rescue. For example, when the Messiah King comes to Israel, he will set at liberty those who are oppressed, meaning he will overthrow our Roman overlords and once again make us an independent nation. However, Jesus knew that his role as Savior had material implications, but the bulk of its force began in the spiritual, first in the heart. Jesus came to provide liberty to those ensnared in their own sin and brokenness. That's true liberty. The passage continues, verse 20. And then Jesus rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." And all spoke well of him and marveled at the gracious words that were coming out of his mouth. And they said, "Is not this Joseph's son?" The people were given pause to consider, isn't this Joseph's son, the carpenter? So they're really forced to reconsider the identity of Christ, because in their mindset, the Messiah is a powerful king. And yet at the same time, Jesus, it's undeniable, has both words and works that have incredible power. So they have to reconsider who he is. Now it helps to understand this, that Nazareth at the time was a tiny town, just a couple of hundred people. And so Jesus likely had cousins, aunts, and uncles in Nazareth. He had former classmates. He would have had neighbors. He would have had the guy that brought milk to the house. He would have had families whose house he built. And so they knew Jesus. And at the same time, they didn't really know Jesus. And so with the Holy Spirit working through Jesus, they were forced to reconsider, who is he? Because he's making some pretty audacious claims. So does he have the authority to back it up? And if he does, what does that mean for us? Will this Jesus be our Savior? We'll see. You can see on this map two red X's that represent miracles that took place during the time of the Old Testament prophets. Note that they're both outside the borders of Israel. One was given to a widow in Zarephath in Phoenicia, and the other the healing of a general named Naaman in the land of the Syrians. Let's read what Jesus says about them. Verse 24, and he said, truly I say to you, no prophet is acceptable in his hometown. But in truth, I tell you, there were many widows in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the heavens were shut up for 3 years and 6 months, and a great famine came over all the land. And Elijah was sent to none of them, but only to Zarephath, to a woman who was a widow. And there were many lepers in Israel at the time of the prophet Elisha. And none of them were cleansed, but only Naam, the Syrian. When they heard these things, all in the synagogue were filled with wrath. It's such a dramatic reversal. From one moment, the crowd is murmuring about how great Jesus is. We're so proud of you. And now they're grinding their teeth at him. What's happening here is Jesus is poking at a sore spot for the people. Both the stories of the widow and the general happened in the time of the kings of Israel. It's a time when, by and large, the people of Israel weren't following the God of the Bible. It's also a time when the people of Israel weren't sharing his truth with neighboring nations. And so, like the lady with the hoard of toilet paper, they had a total inward focus. Christ's hearers were convinced that this was our house, the house of Israel, and we're not responsible to the neighboring nations. In fact, we believe when the Messiah comes, he will dominate, if not totally destroy, those other nations. And yet Jesus made it clear in a later teaching that all the prophets and all the law, both of those teachings, the thrust of the Old Testament, came down and boiled down to two commandments. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and you shall love your neighbor as yourselves. And the history of the Old Testament and the history of the people of Israel prove that they couldn't love the Lord their God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength, and they wouldn't love their neighbor as themselves. It's that inability that Jesus came to rescue them from. It was a message of grace. He's a rescuer to fill up all that they lack, still is. And so his offer was freedom. And yet at the same time, they rejected the identity of Christ and also his authority to make them whole and to send them out. This Jesus, we don't want. And we don't believe he has the right to tell us otherwise. This is how the passage ends. Verse 29, and the people of Nazareth rose up and drove Jesus out of the town and brought him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built so that they could throw him down the cliff. But passing through their midst, Jesus went away. I've been to the sheer cliffs outside Nazareth. This is certainly a murder attempt, and yet Christ in his authority over life and death evades them. It's just not his time to die. This passage centers on the question of authority. Does God have the authority in my life to challenge, offend, and help me as I need to be challenged, offended, and helped? It's about authority. Because the reaction of the people of Nazareth proved that Jesus didn't have that kind of authority for them. And so when we think of authority, the question is, does God have the ability to challenge me in such a way that he's not small? I can't create him, neither can I manage him, neither can I disregard him when I want to. A God that big is big enough to comfort me, because you can't have the comfort of God in your life until you first had the authority of God in your life. It centers on authority. I shared this last year, but I can think of nothing more relevant during our coronavirus concern than this. When I was in middle school, I first started to struggle with obsessive compulsive disorder, OCD. And it's not actually super uncommon. 2 million Americans suffer with OCD. And probably with our health crisis, there's many, many more teetering on the edge of it. For a person with obsessive compulsive disorder, you have obsessive thoughts that you try to manage and control with compulsive behavior. For me, it was a germ phobia. So those were my thoughts, and my repetitive actions were things to try to control that. And so I would wash my hands maybe 30 times a day until they would crack and bleed. It got to the point where I didn't take communion at church or I didn't hug my family. Just too risky. It's a battle that I fought for about 8 years, and it really came to a head when I was in my 20s. I was a youth pastor, and we were taking a group of people from our church to Jamaica for a missions trip. And for those who haven't been there, Jamaica, 20% of it's beautiful. It's what you think of. All the sandals resorts and the golf clubs and golf courses. But 80% of Jamaica is entirely third world. And so it's a country rife with an epidemic of drugs and prostitution and despair. And so the orphanage that we went to, that we were serving at, was a place where most of the kids were abandoned children. There were kids that their parents, who had drug addictions or were into prostitution, had just abandoned them. And they had some serious health concerns, whether it's hepatitis or it was AIDS. So these were some sick children, and it was a rundown orphanage. It's really the worst place for a person with a germ phobia. And so when I came there, I had my guard up. And these kids, they loved to be held. And there was one kid, for some reason, we just formed a connection. His name was Gregory, and he was 3 years old. And I played with him a lot, I held him a lot, and when I wasn't holding him or playing with him, he'd just follow me around and cry. And so Gregory just wormed into my heart, and I kind of let my guard down with Gregory. And it was toward the end of the week, I remember, Gregory had this little saxophone, and he had been playing that saxophone, he's down by my feet, and he'd been kind of sliming it up. He's one of those kids who had that constant run of nose-to-mouth snot, whatever that's called. Nose to mouth, north. He had total north all over. Anyways, he was sliming that saxophone up. And I remember at one point, he looked up at me, and just a beautiful kid, like curly hair, black face. He looked up at me, and with total innocence, just said, "Play," with that saxophone. "Play." I don't know, it just got me, and so I did. I picked it up. Without thinking about it, I put that goobery saxophone right in my mouth. And then all of a sudden, I remembered that I have an open cut, open sore in my mouth. And Gregory's almost certainly sick and maybe something serious. And so for a germ-phobe person with OCD, that was the worst case scenario. I mean, it was a total nightmare. It's called flooding in psychology literature. Flooding is what happens when the worst thing you can imagine happens. And for about 30 seconds, I just went crazy. All I saw was red. And it was in that moment, as just everything the worst happened, that the voice of God spoke to me. Into my mind. And he said to me, "Steve, if I want to, I'll kill you. And if I want to, I'll keep you alive. And you're mine. Just trust me. Don't be afraid." And for me, that was a huge victory point moving forward with my obsessive compulsive disorder. It was really a big victory because the words of God were so powerful to comfort me because the authority of God was powerful in my life. And that, again, is a question of authority. You can't have the comfort of God in your life until you first have his authority. So let me speak to people listening to this sermon, wherever you are, who are just considering the claims of Christ. Maybe you're a church kid who are coming back around, or somehow God just found you to this place. Let me say to you first that it's true, no way around it, that becoming a follower of Christ is inviting the authority of God into your life. It's trust, it's a surrender. When you come to Christ, you're saying, "Jesus, I want you to come in, take over, and change me. I want to lay down my yes to your forgiveness and leadership." It is true. It's authority. And you're asking that to happen. The truth is, you're only giving up that which has stolen your joy and your peace for years. And so it is saying, "God, I want you to be in charge. I want you to have authority with me." And at the same time, it's having the comfort of God. Again, when he's big enough to tell you what your life is to be like and how to determine life and to design it to give his harmony to your life, he's at the same time big enough and close enough to comfort you in times that are uncertain. And so I can only recommend that to you. It's something where it's almost like falling in love. You can only describe it after you've experienced it. And so if that's you, you're considering this, I encourage you to continue to press into that and think about what would it be to have a God so big that he could hold me no matter what happens. Lastly, I'd like to speak to people that are already followers of Christ. So in this time of corona concern, you cannot lose. There's no way around it. So either one of three things is going to happen to you. You're either going to not get sick, you won't get the virus, and you'll be able to boldly do the mission of God for you and to bear the unique hope of Christ to those around you with both word and deed. And God will sustain your health for that purpose. Or, second option, you will get the coronavirus and you'll recover. And in both the illness and the recovery, you'll be able to boldly bear the mission of God that he has for you and take the hope of Christ to those around you, both in word and deed. And God will sustain you for that purpose. Lastly, you may get the coronavirus and not recover. And then you'll pass from this life into eternal life, which is life truly lived. And so for you, God will sustain you for that purpose and reassure you that those that you leave behind that you're worried about, God is big enough to be there enough. And God at the same time is able to make them whole in a way that you wouldn't be able to, even if you live with them for 100 years more. And so that's the peace, that there is a God with enough authority to give them comfort. So I wondered whether I should talk about that, but the truth is to be a pastor also means to prepare you. And so I'm praying against those things. I think God hates death too. That's why Christ came, to defeat death. But just to get you ready, you can't lose. And so whatever takes place, you know that if God is God, he is big enough to speak with his authority into your stress and to bring comfort and hope because you have life eternal. And so with that kind of confidence, you can say to whatever comes to you, it is well with my soul. You can also sing it. And we're about to do that to close. Before we do, I think it's important that one of the most famous songs in Christendom is It Is Well With My Soul. So let me read to you the origin story of that song. The writer of the song, Horatio Spafford, was one of Chicago's most successful lawyers. In 1871, Spafford wrote to some of his friends that he felt like he was sitting on top of the world. Spafford arranged for an extended family trip to Europe. Just prior to the scheduled departure, Spafford received a phone call about a pressing business matter in Chicago, so he told his family to go on ahead and he would join them later. Somehow in the middle of the ocean, the ship strayed into the path of another. Both were traveling at full speed, and in 12 minutes, 266 people lost their lives, including Spafford's four daughters. Several days later, when the survivors had reached Wales, Spafford received a brief six-word telegram from his wife, "Saved alone, what shall I do?" Spafford booked the first ship bound to England. As he was sitting on the deck, the ship's captain approached him and said, "Mr. Spafford, we're approaching the spot where your daughters are now laid to rest." At that moment, Spafford said that a peace came over him as he remembered the words of his friend, Pastor D.L. Moody. Moody had once told him, "One of these days, you're going to read that D.L. Moody of East Northfield is dead. Don't you believe a word of that. I'll be more alive then than I am now." With that thought, Spafford picked up a paper and pencil and jotted down the words that were suddenly on his heart and now famous. "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul."
Blessed be